A Scar is Also Skin, a memoir of stroke, heart attack, and remaking. Written and read by Ben Mckelvey. An unabridged Hachette Australia audio edition. Produced by Hachette Australia, an imprint of Hachette Australia Proprietary Limited. Text copyright, Ben Mckelvey, 2023. Recording copyright, Hachette Australia Proprietary Limited, 2023. Recorded at Square Sound Studios, Sydney, Australia. All rights reserved. For Poppy. O Earth, by Rafat al-Ariya, who was killed in an airstrike in Gaza hours before this recording. O Earth, hug me and hold me tight, or devour me to suffer no more. I love thee, so take me. Make me rich, make me dirt. Gone are the days of serenity. Guns are the words of humanity. I have no food but a thorn, no sport but a sigh. For a soldier needs to feel high. O Earth, if in life I am to hurt, let my dirt in you give birth. O Earth. Prologue. As I write these words, I can see my dad on the screen of my phone, propped up to the left of my computer. He's asleep on a bed in the front room of his cottage in Mandurah, Western Australia. I'm in a room probably designed as a closet, but now serving as my office in our apartment in Bondi. Dad was dying slowly for a couple of years, and now I'm watching him die quickly. I'm not with him because I'm writing this during the waning end of the COVID panic, and Western Australia still has a hard border with the rest of the country. I'm angry that I can't be with my dad, but mostly I feel sadness. It's a sadness that I know will never completely disappear. It'll be folded into me like spice in a simmering dish. Around Dad are his final loves, his partner Marlene, and my sister Laura, with pictures of her daughters, my nieces, nearby. There's very faint music on his stereo, Buddy Holly. And I can also just hear the football commentary coming from a telly he bought at Kmart. Real football, as he calls it. The football of Dad's English youth. Dad is mostly sleeping now, except in a few instances where he raises just above the consciousness threshold. He's not supposed to cross that threshold anymore. We're past that. The goal is to keep him as comfortable as possible, and consciousness is no longer compatible with his comfort. Nurses come into view twice a day to make sure Dad transitions out of this world with as much dignity and ease as possible. It hurts to write these words, and will hurt to reread them when my dad is no longer in this world. I have to get them down, though. There's a lot I don't understand about my dad. I always loved him and he me, but he lived what looked to me like a puzzle of a life. My dad is probably one of the reasons I'm a writer, and he's one of two reasons I'm writing this book. The other reason I'm writing this book is to the right of my computer screen. On a small plastic monitor, splayed out on a mattress, is the image of my sleeping 6-month-old daughter, Poppy. If I stop typing, I hear a faint, soporific symphony, the rising and falling of Dad snoring through the phone speakers to my left, and the consistent hum of Poppy's white noise machine to my right. There is some kind of balance in front of me, with the start and end of life either side of my computer. I can feel joy and sadness as I look between the screens, but not balance. If I'm honest, I feel a rising and familiar panic. My thoughts are disordered. I sat down today in the hope that I could write my way to some kind of balance or shape. That often happens when you write a book. When you sit in front of a blank page, infinite permutations offer themselves, and a storyteller chooses the one that suggests signal through noise, creating meaning from chaos. Everything that's printed is the story. Anything that isn't printed isn't anything at all. I've managed to bring shape and balance to the story of other people's lives, and now I'll try and do it with my life, in this moment of sadness and happiness and pain and disorder, in this moment of mental peril. Lives are easy when there is order. Lives are interesting when there's disorder. Most of us move from one to the other and back again, sometimes even creating a state of disorder, because it's in those disordered times that our lives and we ourselves change. In the same way that we sometimes burn land to promote regrowth and ecological balance, we occasionally bring disorder to our lives in the hope of growth or change. Sometimes unmanaged fires roar through our lives too. Sometimes we have set the fires ourselves, and some are acts of God. These fires offer growth and change as well as death and destruction. This book is about these kinds of fires. It is about change and damage, triumph and loss. It is about my life, and it starts on 16 July 2004, a day like no other I've had. It was the day in which my brain, mind, and life changed, radically and forever. Part 1. Chapter 1, The Snap. I'm 27 years old, fit, young, pretty happy, and also lazy and cynical. I work at a large circulation men's magazine, Ralph, loosely modelled on a very good counterculture British magazine called Loaded. The magazine I work for is not counterculture and is not loaded, but I don't really care. I mostly like the people I work with and the lifestyle the job affords me. Everyone at the magazine drinks for free, and we drink a lot. We go to gigs for free, see movies for free, and are often flown around the world to do this or that. Mostly nonsense. I have a girlfriend who also works in magazines. I don't earn much, but I don't have much ambition, so there's a comfortable equanimity at play. Though I write all day, I'm not yet a writer. My output could be capably described as content, which also describes the innards of a service station hot dog and an IKEA beanbag. I can't remember arriving late to work on 16 July 2004, but I probably did. I would have gossiped and joked through the morning, perhaps replying to some emails and ignoring others. What work was done at Ralph was usually done in the afternoon. I took an early lunch hour with some of the other editorial staff, heading for the gym across the road under the Catholic Club. I was in the gym when it happened. I was hitting the heavy bag, straights to the top of the bag, hooks to the middle, bashing at imaginary kidneys. I felt good, free and young and strong. But inside of me, a blood clot, which had developed in my hip days or weeks before, had broken free from its vascular mooring and was wending its way through my bloodstream and up my body. As a digital timer above a mirror counted down the seconds, I watched my form as I punched. The timer counted down to zero and then dinged three times. I shook the lactic acid from my arms. A large fan blessed me with cool air. My t-shirt was matted against my chest, and my neck and face were hot and crimson. I felt great. I slowly shadowboxed as Tupac's song California Love, one of my favourites, came over the stereo. The timer's chime struck twice, and I was at it again. As I'd been trained to do, I breathed out sharply as I punched, creating abdominal pressure and transverse force into my glove. Shh, thwack, thwack. I would find out later that this is called the Valsalva manoeuvre. I would also find out later that a byproduct of this manoeuvre can be an unusual hemodynamic, with blood travelling in an unusual direction in the body. Unusual, but almost always harmless. Almost always. The clot from my hip smuggled itself up to my chest and then gushed into my heart with some blood, entering the cardiac chambers through my aortic valve. My heart pumped, sending oxygenated blood through my chest, neck, and up towards my brain. The clot followed. I kept hammering away at the bag. Left, right, hook, hook. Psh, 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 psh. I worked and boxed and sweated, and the clot jerked around the vascular highways of my brain with each heartbeat before wedging itself into a tight blood vessel a few inches behind my mouth. The clot was stuck. The vessel was clogged, and blood that should be feeding a section of my brain with oxygen was trapped. The cells in my brain started to choke and die. My mind started to change. I'd been rapping in my head as I boxed until the words of California Love blew away as though they were dust. Soon only the bouncing beat remained. Butterflies waltzed in my vision. A splotchy thought was in my head, one that I could only later define. Strange. That thought continued as I searched for the words to the song that rolled on without me. I couldn't catch any of them in the front of my consciousness, not even the words California or love. Strange. I stopped boxing and pulled my gloves off. I spun my wraps out. I was confused. I knew this song well. Strange. I stood naked in a cold shower. The waltzing butterflies in front of my eyes became kites of spotted light and colour. Strange. I managed to clothe myself and fill my gym bag. I walked onto the street. Strange. The street seemed familiar, but I didn't know where to go. Strange. A face appeared in front of me, also flushed red from gym work. It's a familiar face, yet there's no name associated with it. Strange. The familiar face recognized me. He was a friend. I knew I should say something, but there was nothing to say. I didn't have any words accessible to me. I tried anyway. Something came out of my mouth, verbal sludge. I understood the language of my friend's face. Panic. Something was wrong. I tried again to say what was happening, and again I couldn't. I could tell my friend was shocked and scared. I could tell he was scared for me. Another emotion surged through my brain like a tide. Sad. I didn't know then what I was losing, but I knew it was a lot. I was disconnected, so much so that I couldn't account for exactly what and who I was disconnected from. The disconnection hurt very badly. Sad. Tears grew in my eyes and then built and burst. They streamed down my cheeks. I looked at this friend, this stranger. I shrugged, palms upturned. The taste of my tears as they ran into the corners of my smile is a memory that endures. For the next hour or so, I was at a medical centre on Pitt Street in Sydney, staring blankly at an irritated receptionist and a medical consent form. I was told later she was convinced that my brain was addled on ice. The strong emotional journey my brain had gone through in the first few minutes after the event was likely mostly over. I say likely because I only have grabs of memory after leaving the gym. In the medical centre, I remember the traffic outside, a sign with red letters on a white background, and my friend pleading for an ambulance. I also remember one strong emotion. I'm not sure I can exactly explain the nomenclature of the emotion, but it's the feeling I used to have when, as a little boy, I'd be in bed in a darkened room with heavy skin and a fevered forehead, and I'd hear life continuing outside. The postie pushing letters into the letterbox, kids on their bikes laughing, Dad collecting his things as he prepared to go to work. Jealousy, FOMO, envy, I suppose it was all of those things, but none exactly describes the feeling. Can disconnection be an emotion? If so, it was that. This was something I would feel many times and in varying degrees in the weeks and months to come. I was eventually deposited at the emergency ward of St. Vincent's Hospital, close to King's Cross. The controlled rush of too much work and too few medical staff was all around me. The rush was exacerbated as a junkie was brought in, screaming something either I couldn't hear or couldn't understand. I was led to a partitioned area that served as an examination room, and there I waited, alone. The admitting physician arrived. My heart rate and blood pressure seemed fine. I had no pain nor mobility issues, and there seemed to be no issues with my coordination. I was able to follow a pen with my eyes and mimic movements with my fingers when prompted. I could take instruction after charades and prompting, but I couldn't understand any verbal instructions. I was almost wholly disconnected from language. The doctor decided that something was going on, probably not the drug reaction that was suspected, but I appeared to be stable. He decided that I was not in imminent danger of dying, and I found out later that he issued an initial diagnosis of infection in my cerebrospinal fluid. I was taken to a corner of emergency, and there I watched a silent television. The news came on, and I saw a house on fire. A uniformed policeman behind a microphone, traffic seen from the air, swimmers in a pool, a medal ceremony. I tried so hard to force a narrative onto the images I saw that I developed a migraine. A nurse came and took some of my blood. I smiled blandly. Time passed, but I couldn't really pass how much time. Some friends arrived and I realised they'd finished their workday and it was evening. They would be going home or out for dinner. I would not be. I had that disconnected feeling again. I knew my friends' faces, but not their names. Another doctor came in and started speaking to me. As he spoke, I smiled and nodded in the way a toddler might when being spoken at, understanding the cadence of the language, but little of the content. I still couldn't speak nor comprehend well what was going on. A friend persisted with me until I understood that I would be taken to a ward where they'd administer a spinal tap, also known as a lumbar puncture, so they could draw some cerebrospinal fluid and test it. I remember the smell of the lumbar puncture, acrid and medical, and the sound, the scrape of needle against spine. I remember a doctor, young and serious. I remember his sweater, very colourful, like a Kendone painting, and clearly knitted by a loved one. I remember smiling like a dolt, and I also vividly remember a shining moment of hope. My friends were talking and joking over me as I lay on my hospital bed. I don't really understand their words, but tried to keep up as best I could. So I would smile or chuckle, nod or shake my head when appropriate. I found myself staring at one of my friend's t-shirt. Across it was one word, with illustrations around it. Through the idle chat of my friends, I focused on the shirt's words and pictures with intensity. I couldn't read the words, but I understood the pictures. There were mountains, snow-capped, and there were black bears. I tried to read the word. I managed to read a letter. The first letter, V. I put the sound of the letter in my mind and rolled it around as you might roll a hard candy in your mouth. I managed to pull some other letters from the t-shirt and put those in my mind also. I tried to put the letters together and then the sounds together. I added the pictures. V, V, black bears, N, snowy mountains, Vancouver. The word on the shirt was Vancouver. I said it out loud but quietly. I remember an instinct not to be embarrassed. I tried to put together a sentence explaining my revelation. None came, so I didn't say anything. It felt good knowing that word, hopeful. That night, I was given a bed on a ward. I was already getting better, and I was understanding more and being able to say more. I was still confused by most sentences, but questions like, "Do you want some tea?" could be answered with, "Yes, please," or, "No, thank you." In the relative quiet and dark of the hospital night, I understood that the doctors believed a virus was affecting me. That was something I thought I could handle. I'd had viruses before, and they ran a predictable path. Sickness, then less sickness, then little sickness, and then no sickness. This incident I was experiencing had roughly run that path also, and I was already in the less sickness stage. After finding that my cerebrospinal fluid was normal, and after a CT scan and then an MRI scan, it was decided that I hadn't suffered a virus, but a stroke. This was a few days after my admission. I don't remember exactly when I was first given this information, but I remember doctors saying the word stroke to me when listing the things that probably didn't happen to me, and then when listing things that may have happened to me, and eventually it was described as fact. An older doctor came to me one day with a group of studious-looking men and women who were all younger than I was. They crowded around me while the older doctor rattled off a long string of descriptors to his students. The word ischemic stroke was wedged in the middle. As he was about to move on to the next bed, I touched his arm. "Stroke?" I asked. "Yes." "I had a stroke?" "Yes." "Are you sure?" Flipping through the file at the end of my bed, he hummed until he found what he was looking for. "Yes, stroke," he said. He patted my hand and moved on. At the best of times, it's difficult to understand who's in charge in a hospital and which information is most important. It's even harder when, in a state of shock, illness, or in my case, aphasia, a language, communications, and cognitive disorder that was the main symptom of my stroke. I had a lot of questions, some of which I managed to articulate to my primary doctor. The question I most wanted to know was whether my aphasia would be permanent. He told me that question could be answered by my neurologist. When the neurologist came, he told me that he didn't know. He told me that it can't be known. He said they couldn't identify what had happened, but there had been an occlusion or vascular blockage in the left side of my brain, which was where, for most people, language and computational reasoning is primarily processed. He said he thought that this blockage starved parts of the left side of my brain of blood and, more importantly, the oxygen that was in my blood. Without oxygen, the cells started to die. The occlusion eventually resolved itself, and here we are. I asked about those parts of my brain that were damaged. Were those dead cells dead forever? He said they were. But also that didn't mean that the task those cells performed could never again be performed. Stroke victims, especially young stroke victims, could often attain normal levels of language and comprehension after aphasic episodes. Could? Often? In the days and weeks that came after my admission, this neurologist, who was diligent and intelligent, seemed only to have a minimal interest in my recovery because, in his view, it was rapid. He was more concerned with identifying why I'd suffered a stroke and whether I was about to have another one. I quickly gleaned that he was not in charge of neurological nuance. Then slowly gleaned that no one would or could be in charge of neurological nuance, but the patient. As soon as I could speak and read some words, I was no longer in a state of aphasia, according to my doctors. As far as they were concerned, I was recovered or recovering. The doctor's primary concern was the cause of my stroke. Everything else was a lesser concern. When the lumbar puncture leaked cerebrospinal fluid and gave me migraines during the day, it wasn't considered much of an issue by my doctors. The nausea I suffered from the morphine, issued to lessen my headaches, wasn't thought about much either. These were paint scratches on a spluttering jet engine. 27-year-olds with no prior conditions generally didn't have strokes. After a week in hospital, I hadn't recovered. Not really, not fully. I couldn't speak with any fluidity. I couldn't read much, nor could I speak very well. I couldn't concentrate. I could order a meal and read a label, but I couldn't read a book or tell a multi-stage joke. I must have been hiding my aphasia well, though, because people kept adding to a stack of magazines and books next to my bed. The books were daunting, but in a quiet moment, I decided to have a look at the first page of a short novel called Intimacy by Hanif Qureshi. I sometimes forced my way onto page 2 of the book, but there I had to admit I didn't know what was going on. No matter how slowly I read, I couldn't put information, who a character was, where they were, and what they were doing in my head so I could move on to the next phase of action. It was like attempting to put shoes on for a walk, but endlessly catching your socks on your toes. I knew Hanif Qureshi was a heady author, and even though Intimacy was short and written using simple language, I thought perhaps it was an ambitious place to be getting back to the reading road. I tried some of the magazines on my stack, but I couldn't read anything in those either. I despaired. I knew my brain had changed permanently, and if my brain had changed, then I had changed. I had issues with language, but I wondered what other neurological functions had been impaired and what parts of me were now gone, cognitively, emotionally, and essentially. Chapter 2, Morning Light. The days in hospital were full, even the days when I was just in the business of waiting. There were always doctors who I needed to see, who were rumoured to be on their way, and there were often tests that were purported to be happening. There were nurses coming to check my bowels and cannulas to be replaced, and there were well-meaning visitors and the offer of inedible meals. There were also migraines and the morphine and the nausea. So during the daytime, there usually wasn't too much opportunity to ruminate. Things were different at night, however. Hospitals generally clear out when the sun sets, except for a skeleton staff and, of course, the inpatients. For some reason, my nausea and migraines sometimes abated at night, and my mind was relatively clear. I often spent time thinking about how an inability to read and write was probably going to be an impediment to my magazine career, even as an editor at Ralph. There was a more fundamental question resonating in my head, however. Was I the same person who I had been previously? Did I have an issue with articulating my memories, thoughts, and emotions? Or had those memories, thoughts, and emotions themselves been compromised? I didn't speak to anyone about this while I was in hospital, perhaps because I didn't have the words to properly explain myself, or perhaps because no one had brought the subject up, and in hospital it's quite poor form to complain to the people around you about speculations, especially when, all things considered, you've already been quite fortunate. After all, I could walk and talk. But that question was always in my mind, at least at night. I remember those hospital nights as long. I'd been a night owl, usually going to bed well after midnight, and my circadian rhythms were at odds with the cadence of hospital life, which was built around geriatric patients. Many of the patients on my ward were older men who fell straight to sleep as soon as the lights on the ward dimmed at 8. They filled the night with cacophonous snores and the odd loud fart. Some of the patients on my ward stayed awake, cranking their tiny personal speakers to the maximum volume as they watched the ABC. Sometimes I also turned on the little cathode ray tube TV above my bed and pressed the tinny speaker against my ear. In the first week of hospital, I surfed endlessly through the 5 channels as I thought about something else. In my second week in hospital, however, I surfed my way over to SBS to find that Stanley Kubrick's film Paths of Glory was about to start as part of a Kubrick retrospective running all week. That retrospective made my nights in hospital far easier, and also the days, as I had something to look forward to. The television I watched the films on was perhaps 14 inches diagonally, the screen curved and broadcasting in fuzzy standard definition. The speaker was comparable to the kind that greets you when entering a McDonald's drive-thru. And yet, in my mind, the sights and sounds of those films are impeccable and immersive and attached to feelings of exhilaration. In hospital, my mind was soaring with possibilities. I was relieved to know that I could still feel something when I watched. And sometime in the second week in hospital, I found that I could still connect to my feelings when I read. One night, I picked up an omnibus of Harvey Pekar's autobiographical comic books, American Splendor, and was sucked into the minutiae of his seemingly unremarkable life as a twice-divorced Jewish file clerk in Cleveland. While the books are funny, there are no jokes. The stories are about the nuance of life, the grain and texture that makes us feel our days as they go by. I was engaged with the stories, not just intellectually, but emotionally. In reading American Splendor, I didn't only have shoes and socks on. I was walking, running, jumping. This is what I'd always loved, ever since I was a little kid. I loved to read. I loved to watch. I loved to understand other people and the world through a medium. I was often troubled by how quickly I'd be left behind, in conversation and context. When my friends and girlfriends spoke in hospital, it was sometimes as though I was hearing them speak in another language, and I would desperately try to grab a word or phrase that could drag me into the conversation. When I spoke, I saw in their faces the polite patience people employ when listening to a non-English speaker. I knew that sometimes they were waiting for me to come to my confused point so we could all move along. I grew scared of being left behind in conversations and in life. Even only after 2 weeks, it felt like life was continuing without me and would continue to happen without me. I feared that the life in front of me might be less meaningful than the one behind me. I might understand less and feel less, although I was probably confusing the broader numbing effects of life in hospital with the specific and personal effect of the brain damage I had suffered. I had always been an overthinker. Whenever I battled through a clouding surplus of thought in one area of my life, I often tried to think my way to clarity. I then believed that only thought could conquer thought. That wasn't going to work here. I was overthinking at a time when I was least equipped for it. I know now that I also use diversion when I start overthinking. That wasn't working after my stroke until Harvey Pekar and Stanley Kubrick came to my ward. They brought diversion, but they also brought hope that my life going forward might be different to my old life, but that it might not be lesser. As I read and watched, I thought that perhaps my capacity for language would be affected, but not my capacity for feeling. Harvey Pekar and Stanley Kubrick had a lot to say to me. Most importantly, you can still connect deeply. And regardless of whether you'll write again or even read a novel, there is marrow left in the bone that is life. I'd been in hospital a couple of weeks and my migraines and nausea had stopped. I'd stopped taking morphine and I'd been disconnected from my heart monitor and drip. I was getting better. I'd stopped thinking so much as well. I read comics, watched movies, and with the prodding and testing over, I was ready to go home. One night around this time, a man died on the ward. I woke in the dark early morning to a minor commotion of nurses, doctors, and crash carts. The commotion gave way to snoring and the slow, steady beeps of machines around me. Orderlies arrived, and I saw a body being taken away on a gurney. I fell asleep again and woke with the ward, which was unaffected by the loss of the man. Breakfast came. Nurses chattered. Old men stared out the window. The day unfolded. The man who had died was just one of the men on the ward. I wasn't even sure which one. He was probably lonely. Only a fraction of the old men received visitors, and probably not expecting for his life to end when it did. It was such an anonymous, matter-of-fact occurrence, and that was what chilled me. Instead of thinking about death and spiraling into overthinking, my mind gave me visceral wants. I wanted a beer and a second beer. I wanted fat, salt, and sugar. I wanted to blast Queens of the Stone Age, get laid, and take a big shit in my own toilet. I really wanted to get the hell out of hospital. I wasn't receiving any treatments, nor was I undergoing any tests, but my doctors were still reluctant to release me without identifying the source of the stroke. Eventually, one of my doctors told me they were going to convene a council where all of my data would be presented to a large gathering of specialists in the hope of identifying a specific diagnosis. After settling on a broad-spectrum diagnosis of unidentified predisposition to thrombus, I was finally prepped for discharge. I was visited by a physiotherapist, an occupational therapist, and a speech and language therapist, which was the standard bookend to any hospital admission after a stroke. The physiotherapist had no work to do, nor the speech therapist. I'd been looking forward to seeing the occupational therapist because I'd asked numerous doctors when we were going to start treatment that would help bring me back to myself. That was what I considered a full recovery, with my thoughts and language as they had been before. I was never satisfied with the answers I got. There didn't seem to be anyone who was going to be helping me return to me, except this occupational therapist. My hopes were too high and I was disappointed after her visit. That wasn't an indictment of her or her field, but on my wildly unrealistic expectations. I wanted a lot. I knew I wasn't thinking as I used to, nor using language as I had before. It was taking me a long time to explain things that I knew should be able to be explained quickly. I knew my brain was often stuck with its first attempt at a word, unable to find a second or third example once a first had been lodged in my mind. I knew I was often mixing up my tenses, mistaking today for yesterday and before and after, but only in speech, not in my mind. I knew I meant tomorrow. I wanted to know why. Even when I had all the required parts of a sentence or paragraph in my mind, I couldn't assemble them properly. I wanted to know why there were concepts I understood, but that I had seemingly lost the words for. I still struggle to find the word codependent when I need it for some reason. I wanted to know why sometimes I'd see an empty word space approaching and then I'd be stuck mid-sentence of mid-thought. I built a defense against this, telling my friends and family that I was just going to stick the word cornflakes in front of my mind and say that instead of the incorrect word. I expected my occupational therapist to tell a story, arriving with CT and MRI scans in the way that an orthopedic specialist might, identifying a tear or a break, and then give me strategies for recovery and reconstruction. What was my issue? Was it memory, cognition, language, a mix? I was keen to know. Instead, she came in with flashcards of clip art, shapes and colours. Could I identify this? It's a sailboat. And this colour, green. And this shape, it's a circle. I asked her a few of my questions about language and emotion, and she told me that those questions were a little outside her field. I was disheartened. She continued with her flashcards. Of course I could identify what was on the cards. This was an umbrella, a pentagon, a wave. This, she asked? Of course, it was a circle. No, not a circle. It had straight lines, so it was a circle? No, it was pointy. Circles aren't pointy. It's a circle, fuck me. No, not a circle, but a square. Not a square, not quite a square. It's half a square, I said. Nearly, she enthused. I was discharged from hospital, went home and resumed my life, essentially. I couldn't read easily yet. I still used the word cornflakes for missing words. But from the outside, it seemed no other aspect of my life had been significantly affected. From the inside, though, things were definitely different. If I allowed myself any quietude, there was no getting away from the fact that my brain had changed, and so had I. I didn't want a brain that had changed. I didn't want a different life, so the answer to that problem was to refuse any moments of quietude that may intrude. I wasn't sick, and I wasn't even really convalescing, so I just filled my life up with the joys of Sydney for a few weeks until, with an aching liver, clothes that smelled like an ashtray, I was an ardent non-smoker, but the indoor smoking ban in Sydney was still a couple of years away, and ringing ears, I returned to work. Initially, I did tasks that required the least amount of English comprehension and composition, captioning, interviewing glamour models and personalities to be used as Q&A text, and writing short movie and music reviews. Then, perhaps 4 months after the stroke, I attempted my first long-form piece of writing. The story required me to go to Willowbank Raceway in Queensland and write a piece about a family who had made money in the crane business and had put that money into a drag racing team which they owned and operated. After returning to Sydney, I spent weeks arranging and rearranging text and quotes that couldn't have been more than 2,000 words. I convinced myself that there was sense in the document that I'd created, that I'd introduced people, a place, and milieu, and through description and quotes, I'd taken the reader on a journey. What I'd written was unreadable gabble. The filing process in our office was that when you had a finished story, you'd move the first draft of it onto the office server so it could be sub-edited, and then a printed copy would be left on the magazine editor's desk. My desk had a direct line of sight to the editor, and I watched him pick my feature up and slump deeper and deeper into his chair as he read. I felt my face flush. Days after the stroke, and before it was known that I'd had a stroke, a card arrived from the magazine, and the editor had written, "Entire feature written in Mckelvey gibberish? By crikey, I think it may work." I could see in his posture now, head in his hands, that he knew an entire feature written in gibberish was not going to work. It was depressing, but the absurdity and awkwardness of the situation also amused me.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.